Fetal cardiology is actually a retrograde extension of pediatric cardiology, and it has been an upcoming field in the last couple of years, and it's so interesting that multiple specialties are getting involved into it, and pediatricians, especially the neonatologists, are a part and a parcel of treating babies in fetus with congenital heart disease. So it was very interesting that today, for the first time, I am taking a talk on fetal cardiology for pediatricians, and I realized that there is so much for all of us as pediatricians to know about this. Can you on the presentation, please? Okay, so till the presentation is on, what happens is the fetal medicine specialists, they are basically radiologists and gynecologists, and then we have the OBGY team dealing with the pregnancy component, then we have the pediatric cardiologist and the cardiac surgeons dealing with the cardiac part, and then we have the neonatologists who take care of the immediate postnatal service for the baby. Now, what all a pediatrician foremost is, we need to try to understand what is the role of fetal echo in picking up congenital heart diseases very early. Now, as a pediatrician, we know that pulse oximeter is the most important way to pick up a congenital heart disease early. However, because of the transitional circulation, sometimes it can happen that even with a pulse oximeter, we may not pick up, with a good cardiac examination, we cannot pick up a congenital heart disease. And hence, there is a role of fetal echo. So let's just run through the initial few slides. So that's the importance of a fetal echo, which we will see in detail. The second is the indications of fetal echo. Third is the impact of fetal echo. Does it really make a difference on the outcome of a congenital heart disease? And fourth, limitations of any investigation, fetal echo limitations. Now let's see, do we really need a fetal echo as a screening tool for congenital heart disease? Now let's see this case where we have a baby at birth is doing completely fine and then lands up in a pediatric OPD on day 5 with tachypnea and desaturation. And you see an x-ray like this, and we can understand that the heart size is definitely bigger and the lung fields appear oligemic. ECG quiet does not look okay. You can see this QRS complexes, they look so slurred. So as a pediatrician, we know that this is something which is not correct with the baby's heart. And then you get an echo done. Now you can see here in the first picture, the tricuspid valve appears displaced and there is significant regurgitation of the tricuspid valve. When we open up the pulmonary valve, we realize that very, very little flow going across the pulmonary valve. So this is what? This is an Epstein's anomaly of the tricuspid valve with a severe critical pulmonary stenosis. So here you can see the valve gets displaced, the functional RV cavity is very small, and severe TR makes very little flow going into the lung fields. And this is a situation where we would consider prostaglandins. So prostaglandin was started and the BT shunt was planned, but it was a little later and baby succumbed. Now this is all what happened because of ductal closure. So was there a way we could have prevented this? Yes, we could have diagnosed this baby a little early. A little early means what? Could we have diagnosed it on day 1, day 2, day 3 of life? So now let's see, amongst the congenital heart diseases, we have 75% of heart diseases which are not critical, but 24% of the heart diseases are critical. Unfortunately, amongst this critical heart diseases which need intervention in the first 1 month of life, 30% of these babies are discharged along with the mother from the hospital undiagnosed, and that's again because the presence of PDA can mask the clinical diagnosis of a congenital heart disease. And hence we need to understand that a normal examination of a newborn does not exclude a congenital heart disease, even critical. And hence we understand that to pick up early means we need to pick them up in fetal life. Now coming down to the second question, when do we do a fetal echo? When, in terms of which mothers and which duration of gestation? Now we can see here that there are three types of scans which are considered for the heart in pregnancy. One is a basic scan where during the anomaly scan, the fetal medicine specialist will see a four-chambered heart. and this can pick up to 50% of heart diseases. The second step is an extended basic scan where we can include the outflow tracts in addition to a four-chambered heart during an anomaly scan, and this picks up approximately 80% of the heart diseases. And the last is a fetal echo, that is the heart examination in detail. It is indicated in high-risk mothers, and we have a list of indications where a fetal echo is indicated. However, high-risk mothers, if we screen all high-risk mothers, we are unfortunately going to pick up only 20% of the congenital heart diseases. That means 80% of the CHDs happen in mothers without any risk. So it again brings us to a point where we need to emphasize on the extended basic scans when they do the anomaly scans. So the current protocol says that routinely, when an anomaly scan is done, they need to screen out at multiple levels and include the outflow tracts and the three vessel view in the anomaly scan so that we can pick up maximum number of congenital heart diseases in fetal life so that we can give them a better outcome. Now, when do we do a fetal echo? Very small baby, the visualization is difficult. A later in gestation, calcification of the ribs will not allow us to see the baby. And hence, 18 to 24 weeks is an ideal time. However, because in India, 20 weeks is the legal age of termination, we have 16 to 18 weeks as an ideal age for doing a fetal echo. But sometimes we do first trimester fetal echoes in high-risk mothers. This could be transvaginal or transabdominal, especially if the first baby is having a complex congenital heart disease. We do a first trimester fetal echo in high-risk mothers. And sometimes if they have an abnormal NT scan, we still do a first trimester fetal echo. Remember that technically it cannot be done bedside with our cardiac probes or on a sonography machine. We use a curvilinear probe and a specific frame rate for getting a fetal echo done. So now with this understanding, we come to the third point. What is the impact of fetal echo on the outcomes of infants when they get diagnosed antenatally? Remember that when we have a diagnosis of fetal echo, the first most important thing which goes is counseling of the parents, and second is consideration about any intervention in antenatal period, which could be in terms of ruling out chromosomal or extra cardiac problems, or it could be intervention in utero, for example, for arrhythmias, or it could be monitoring serially during pregnancy. It could be changing the time, place, or mode of delivery. And it could be finally the postnatal where the neonatologists come into picture in terms of early intervention. We will take very few cases in view of less time. So let us see this, and we can see here that we can see two vessels which are parallel to each other. This is transposition of great arteries, and transposition of great arteries is a condition which is usually in isolation. These children, when they have no VSD, they are expected to be sick at birth. We need to deliver them at a tertiary center. We keep prostaglandin standby, and surgery is the first foremost option. If we cannot offer them arterial switch, then only we go for a septostomy and later on an atrial switch. Remember, arterial switch operation is the preferred mode of option with less mortality and less chances of redo surgeries. So when we diagnose transposition antenatally, we have the baby less hypoxic with less operative mortality and better long-term outcomes. Now, in contrast to this, we can see here, we have a single great vessel which is giving rise to pulmonary artery and aorta. This is the truncus arteriosus. As we know, it's a conotruncal malformation with a very high incidence. One third of these babies have Digoxin syndrome, and these babies are expected to be stable at birth unless and until they have truncal valve regurgitation or interrupted arch. So these babies get surgery done a little later in life, by 1.5 months to 2 months of life, and then they need redo surgeries. So a fetal echo diagnosis of truncus arteriosus most of the times does not change the place of delivery and does not need any modification immediately after birth. However, it is very important to rule out associated chromosomal anomaly and counsel the parents accordingly. Truncus arteriosus diagnosis in fetal life does not make much difference for us in terms of morbidity and mortality later in life. You can see here it's a single ventricle. So single ventricle, as we know, that we cannot give a two pump repair to the child. So it is palliative, multiple surgeries in these situations where termination is sometimes often considered and respected when parents opt for it. Gynecologists are told not to do a cesarean for the mother. The babies in terms of PAH situation are expected to be stable at birth. Whenever there is a single ventricle, hypoplastic left heart, parents need to understand that the recurrence risk in second baby is relatively high. This baby ends up getting a banding, a Glenn and a Fontan operation. But remember that you have a mortality even in between the two stages, and not all babies complete a Fontan. Sometimes these babies end up getting a pacemaker in their life. So overall, the morbidity is high and mortality is high with 70% 10-year survival rate. There are few negative risk factors, including a morphological right ventricle and presence of regurgitation in the only valve which we have. Now, in contrast to this, if you see a hypoplastic left heart where you know that right ventricle is the only ventricle, remember that there are situations in this baby where sometimes if there is RV dysfunction in fetal life, we cannot offer any surgery to them. But if they are ideal candidates, we do Norwood stage 1 on first 24 hours of life with a 50% survival for 5 years. HLHS with a hyperplastic left ventricle and a restrictive foramen oval in fetal life itself is a very high risk factor. So this is a situation which helps us counseling the parents about the mortality long term. But remember that if we pick them up early in fetal life, these babies do much better than picking them up on day 3, day 4, day 5, including the neurocognitive outcomes has been found to be much better. Ventricular septal effects is the most common CHD as a pediatrician we would see, and we can see here there are two things which we pay attention in fetal life: the size and the site. The associated chromosomal anomalies are very rare with isolated VSDs. If we see a VSD more than 5 millimeters in fetal life, it is less likely to close. So this is how a fetal VSD can be used for prognosticating. Lots of muscular VSDs in fetal life could close over time. There are VSDs which are moderate to large, which would need surgery later in life. The presence of VSD, the only thing we do is reassurance to parents. I think I would skip pulmonary atresia. We know it is ductal dependent with high incidence of redo surgeries and chromosomal anomalies. And tetralogy of Fallot being the commonest congenital heart defect, most of these babies are stable at birth, needing sometimes one, sometimes two surgeries, but the third decade they may have a decline, and fetal echo helps us to prognosticate these parents. Cardiac tumors, most common rhabdomyoma, SVT occasionally seen with them. Neonatologists need to follow them up for arrhythmias, sometimes in the NICU in the first 1 month of life. Tuberous sclerosis could indicate a negative prognosticating factor. Bradyarrhythmia, anytime picked up in fetal life, half of the times it could be complete heart block, and sometimes it could be associated with a congenital heart disease. Maternal RORLA antibodies could be present, and 85% of these babies need a pacemaker at birth. If it's immune mediated, sometimes the mother gets treated with steroids, and baby might need early delivery if there is an evidence of high drops in fetal life. Similarly, tachyarrhythmias occasionally associated with structural heart disease. Most common is reentrant tachycardia. Mother getting treated with maternal antiarrhythmics in absence of high drops do beautifully well. And at birth, again, they have reappearance of SVT where we need an NICU support, and sometimes early delivery again here if there is evidence of high drops. I think we understand that prenatally diagnosed congenital heart disease helps us in giving a thought whether do we or can we treat it antenatally. We can have a planned delivery with a delivery in a tertiary center. Prostaglandin infusion standby. Intubation ventilation can help us getting the baby less hypoxic and less acidotic, and preventing neonatal complications, and finally giving us improved long-term outcome. So the message is that it definitely helps us for arrhythmias and ductal-dependent lesions. With this understanding, we come to the last thought, whether does it have limitations? And yes, it does have limitations because there are lesions like ASD, PDA, which can be physiological. There are lesions like pulmi stenosis, which can become pulmi atresia. So lesions could evolve. Pulmi venous drainage is very little. So partial anomalous pulmi venous drainage cannot be picked up. And lesions like coarctation needs to be confirmed after birth. So at the end of it, when we counsel the parents, we put all the congenital heart diseases this way, where we have VSD coarts on the lighter side and we have single ventricle and truncus on the heavier side and tetralogy of Fallot somewhere in between. And we also understand the recurrence risk for the parents to have in the subsequent pregnancies when we counsel the parents. The final concluding message is that as a pediatrician, do not overlook the antenatal cardiac findings. Monitor the saturations for ductal-dependent suspected pulmi lesions and monitor the perfusion for ductal-dependent systemic lesions. For borderline lesions, we sometimes need NICU care for the first 72 hours till the PDA closes and the pulmi vascular resistance falls. The message is fetal cardiology is an important component of pediatric cardiology. Thank you so much.